So just the other day, I was walking around near where I live, thinking about the upcoming MLS season and wearing the same exact clothes I'm wearing now, and I was like, "F it, let's do another preview." And so here I am, ready to talk about half of the 23 teams that are now in MLS in the league's 23rd year of existence, 12 of which I played in. So proud of myself. Anyway, let's get right to it by deciding which half of the teams, or maybe it's easier to say which conference, we're gonna start with first. And actually, before I do that, let me quickly explain the league. There are 12 teams in the Western Conference and 11 in the Eastern Conference this season, with plans to add more, of course, because that's what we do here. We love expanding. So the two top teams after 34 games in each conference, not just overall, but in each conference, will get an automatic bye in the first round of the playoffs, while the third place team in both conferences will host the sixth best team in each conference in a winner takes all one-off playoff game, and fourth will host fifth in the same stakes, right? A one-off playoff game. Then the winner of those two games will advance to face one of the two top seeds who got the bye in a two-legged affair, which we will call the quarterfinals, because there are only eight teams left in this postseason tournament. And the winners of that will play in a two-legged semifinal until they get to the MLS Cup final, which is the best team in the West pitted against the best team in the East, and it's only one game, and it's gonna be hosted by the team that had the better record in the regular season. So you see, the regular season does matter. Also, there are five trophies to win every season, and the first one is the Supporter Shield, which is given to the team with the best regular season record. The second one is the US Open Cup, which is our FA Cup, which means teams from all levels can try to enter to win. Then there's MLS Cup, which I just explained. I thought I explained it pretty well. Then the CONCACAF Champions League, which no MLS team has ever won before, but I really like Toronto FC's chances this season because they're pretty good. And then if you win the CONCACAF Champions League, you enter into the FIFA Club World Cup, but since we haven't won the CONCACAF Champions League, no MLS team has ever won that either, so there's some work to do for MLS in general. Last season, Toronto FC became the first team in MLS history to win a treble. They won Canada's Cup competition, then they had the best regular season record to win the Supporters Shield, and then they took down the Seattle Sounders in MLS Cup, which was a very, very big deal, so congrats again to them. But that's all in the past, and now it's time to look forward to this new season. So let's just start with the Eastern Conference, and let's just say the Columbus Crew. The Crew, who are also known as the hardest working team in America, who are definitely moving to Austin, Texas next season, which means for all of you Save the Crew hashtaggers out there, you might want to switch it to the hashtag Save Your Energy. Well, this is the year, and the last year, and I'm speaking to the players and coaches at this moment, for you guys to do something special for all of the people who have been supporting the team since it started in 1996. But after last season, where the Crew finished fifth in the East, but only 3 points behind second place NYCFC, and then only lost 1-0 to the eventual champions Toronto FC over two legs, I feel like that's a pretty solid season, especially considering the move of the team to Texas was being announced, or threatened to being announced, at the end of last season, which could have thrown off their concentration, but it didn't, and I respect that. However, I don't think they've gotten better in the offseason. After losing leading scorer Ola Kamara and one of their best playmakers in Justin Miram, and their speed up top with Kakuta Mane, who did a very good job of keeping the defense honest, and yes, I know they replaced him with Jossie Zardes, who I like a lot, but I think Kamara is better, and Ricardo Clark, who I adore, but he's pretty much as old as I am, and Mike Grella, who I also like a lot, but he's not gonna give you that offensive output of the guys that left. So I see the Crew fighting for one of the last playoff spots, but before I decide where they're gonna end up, let's throw it over to our man on the ground in Columbus, Jimmy Conrad. Thanks, Jimmy. So I am here outside of the first soccer-specific stadium in the United States, and I get the sense that fans are conflicted. On one hand, they don't wanna show up to games because they don't wanna put money into the pocket of the owner that is moving the team. But on the other hand, they want to pack the stadium to show everyone, including this owner that they think is, well, it rhymes with class ball, that the team is loved here. So I'm not sure what is going to happen outside of club legend Frankie Hadick drinking twice as many espressos to make up for any energy that might be lacking in the stadium on game days. And in Frankie we trust, so I'm gonna say his extra energy boost is gonna get them that last playoff spot, sixth. And next up, let's head to the nation's capital to talk about anything other than politics, and in this case, DC United. Now, outside of having the best looking kits in the league this season and getting rid of a lot of their old players in the offseason to bring in some new and younger and exciting guys, and finally having a brand new stadium to play in, and these are all the positives that I can see. They retained my old friend and club legend Ben Olsen as coach after being the worst team in the league last year, and I'm not sure too many coaches around the world can say they got last and still had a job the following year, so congrats to Ben. And they actually will not have a brand new stadium to play in until July 14th, because Audi Field isn't gonna be ready yet, which means that is a lot of road games for them to play, 12 to be exact, and 2 home games at temporary fields until they can call Audi Field their home. But even then, in their first home game, it's gonna be their first time playing there, just like their opponent, which means I think their home field advantage isn't really gonna kick in until 2019. So I think this season is gonna be a pretty big struggle for them, and they're gonna finish 9th. And up next, it's time to go to where all the old people go to retire, the state of Florida, and wax poetic about Orlando City. Now, you would think that after losing the last player to win the Ballon d'Or, not named Messi or Ronaldo, to retirement, who is also your captain, who is also known as Kaká, and your best and most impactful striker when he was motivated, Kyle Larin, to Besiktas, it would hurt your team tremendously. But I think it's gonna be the opposite for this team and their coach, Jason Christ, because they had a terrific offseason. Isn't that right, Jimmy?
That is 100% correct, Jimmy, because the sun is shining, the air is Disney-fied, and everyone in Orlando is feeling great about their chances this season because they added Sasha Kljestan, who led the league in assists the last 2 seasons, Justin Miram, who can win a game all by himself, a young Paraguayan number 10 in Josue Coleman, an MLS Cup winning defensive midfielder who grew up in Barcelona's La Masia Academy in Uri Rossell, a Senegalese international at center back, and the reigning NASL MVP and Golden Boot winner. And do I need to go on?
No, you don't, because Orlando did what every team should do when you struggle the year before, and that is strengthen the spine of your team right down the middle. Get some experience, get some talent, get some leadership, and they did that. And I think they did it better than any other team in MLS's past off season, and that is going to make them a force to be reckoned with. And I feel like they're gonna make the biggest jump in MLS. They're gonna finish 4th. And now we head north of the border where they mainly speak French to discuss in English. Our friends, the Montreal Impact. About 5 or 6 weeks before the end of the season in 2017, they were in the mix for a playoff spot, but then they lost their last 5 games. They finished 10th and watched their Canadian rivals, Toronto FC, win everything. So they fired their coach, re-signed their best player and one of the best players in the league, Ignacio Piatti, and got a whole bunch of new players, but the new coach is from Europe, and coaches from Europe historically don't tend to do well in MLS. They're like, what is the GAM and the TAM and all these rules? And a lot of their new players are from Europe as well, just like a lot of their old players were, who couldn't cut it in a league that is more difficult than most people give it credit for. So I think Montreal will be good and have some good games along the way, but very inconsistent. 8th. And next up, it's the team in the city of brotherly love, the Philadelphia Union, who after finishing 8th last season in the East, will want to make a big splash in a very crowded sports market by trying to match the Super Bowl winning, history making Philadelphia Eagles, if that's even possible, by winning a trophy this season. But let's see what Jimmy has to say, who's in Philadelphia now. Hey, Jimmy.
David Akam.
Yes, I know. He's their big and only significant offseason signing, and I really like his game a lot, but you can't really think that one guy is gonna be able to turn it around by himself.
Like Ernie Stewart?
Yes, great example, because he's been with the club a few years now, and everyone thought, myself included, that this former US men's national team player with a wealth of on the field and front office experience would help this club turn things around, but I guess, again, it was foolish to think that one guy could do it by himself.
So why are you even asking me anything if you already have all the answers?
Yes, I'm not sure though, other than to get confirmation from you about what we both know to be true. That despite the Union having good players and an awesome guy as coach in Jim Curtin, I love that dude, they're not gonna be good again this season. And maybe that's because they're cursed. I don't know. 11th. And now let's head to New Jersey to talk about the New York Red Bulls. Because they love getting rid of whoever truly loves being a part of their club. 3 years ago, they unceremoniously fired their club legend and then head coach Mike Pecky, who had just led them to the Eastern Conference Final. Then 2 years ago, Dax McCarty, who wore the captain's armband with pride, was shipped off to Chicago. And then at the end of last year, it was new captain Sasha Kljestan's turn, and he was shipped off to Orlando. So I'm not sure what kind of messaging head coach Jesse Marsh is trying to send to his team, but it's definitely not loyalty. And from my experience, having a coach that had my back made a big difference in how I played because I was at peace, which gave me a lot of confidence because I was settled and I knew my role within the team. But with things always being unsettled every season with the Red Bulls, or at least it feels that way, and with the leaders of the team being replaced each year, that doesn't lead to good things no matter how talented your team is. And I do think they are talented, they're just not gonna maximize their potential. So I'll say fifth. And now let's actually head to New York City proper and talk a little NYCFC. Because as sad as I am to say this out loud,
don't do it.
I have to do it because it's true.
You're gonna regret it.
But the truth must be spoken. And the truth is, NYCFC is gonna be better without our Lord and Savior, Andrea Pirlo.
This is blasphemy.
I know it is okay, but it had to be said because they are going to be better for it by having younger and cheaper players that actually wanna do the work so they'll be able to cover more ground and just be stronger in a very important part of the field. And then you have captain and superstar striker David Villa, who is in the last year of his contract. So you know he's gonna be flying around to try to win one more trophy in his career before he leaves, or he's gonna be flying around to secure another big contract. Either way, he's gonna be properly motivated to do great things this season like he always does, because the guy is a top professional. And then you have a manager in Patrick Vieira, who is a very smart player, if you guys remember, and he's only gonna get smarter as a manager as he learns more about his own personal coaching style, because he seems reflective like that. Like, he goes, what could Patrick do better today? I like that about him. And as he learns more about the league that he's coaching in. So I fully expect NYCFC to be better than last year and challenge Toronto FC for the top spot in the East. But until they prove otherwise, I'm just gonna put them in second, but they could get first, but I'm gonna say second. And now let's head to the outskirts of Boston for the New England Revolution, who might be my new favorite team in MLS because after firing their club legend as coach Jay Heaps at the end of last season, they hired a former US men's national team player turned pundit in the media with zero coaching experience, which is pretty much how you would describe me. So if any teams want me as their head coach, I'm available. But I'm talking about Brad Friedel. Yes, the legendary American goalkeeper is the new coach of the Revolution, and no one knows how the hell he's going to do. But I think he can use that to his advantage, especially if his players buy into his philosophy.
Hey, Jimmy, I know you didn't throw it to me, but do you know which accent Brad is going to use as coach? I'm a little curious.
I don't.
I only asked because after growing up in Ohio, he played in England for a long time, and then he came back with an English accent, which I don't know what you would call that other than pretentious.
Actually, I would call it genius, because he clearly knows that you get paid more as a coach in this country if you have an English accent, so fair play to him.
You got me there, you daft.
But honestly, as much as I'm pulling for him, because if he does well, then I can make a play to leave what I'm doing now to take over a team, because again, I am available if anybody wants me. I think it's just gonna take Mr. Friedel some time to figure things out, so I'm gonna say 10th. And up next, let's go to the Windy City, or kinda near the Windy City, for the Chicago Fire, who shocked the league in a few different ways last season. One, they stole one of the league's most consistent players in Dax McCarty away from a rival, which I still can't believe the Red Bulls thought that was a good idea. Like, let's get rid of the Ginger Ninja, because yeah, that doesn't make any sense. And two, they signed a World Cup winner in Bastian Schweinsteiger to anchor and lead their team, which I believe worked to great effect. And three, they signed a player from Legia Warsaw whose name is Nemanja Nikolic, who has scored goals no matter what league or what level he's played at or in or whatever the hell I'm trying to say. And he proved it again by winning the Golden Boot with 24 goals in his first MLS season. However, they were the worst team in the league the year before, so expectations were obviously low. Then they did these three things that I mentioned and they finished in third, so everybody's like, woo, rainbows and unicorns, and we're so great. But then they lost at home in the first round of the playoffs to the New York Red Bulls 4-0, and that's, it was kind of embarrassing. So maybe the Red Bulls were right to let Dax go, even though it doesn't feel that way in my heart. So either way, the moral of my Chicago Fire story is they aren't gonna sneak up on anybody this year. Dax and Schweinsteiger are a year older, and Nikolic will not match the goal totals he did the year before because defenses now know how to defend him a little bit better, and that's gonna make it harder for him to hit the back of the net, which means a drop off is in order. So, sorry guys, seventh. And now we head down to the Dirty South and Atlanta United, who came out of nowhere in their first ever season with their brand new players and their brand new coach and their brand new stadium and their brand new incredibly rabid and awesome fan base to surprise pretty much everyone, including themselves, if they're being honest with themselves. I just said themselves three times now to finish fourth and be the talk of the league for most of the season before their high-powered offense couldn't find a goal in their 0-0 draw over 120 minutes, which led to them losing to the Crew in penalties in their first ever playoff game. So, a lot of history was made for this club and they're sitting in year one and they have a lot to be proud of, but year two is always harder because now there are expectations, big ones, and I think that'll be their new, brand new challenge. Anyway, Jimmy, do you have anything to add?
Yes, I do, in fact, and I'm just happy to see that the rap game is finally taking notice of the sport in this country. I mean, did you see 2 Chainz in the promos? The league has made it, baby!
I meant, did you have anything of substance to add?
What are you talking about? Pop culture takes its cues from the rap game. They are the tastemakers of what's cool and what is not. So if they think soccer is cool, then it's cool and it has arrived. So it doesn't get any more substance than that.
I meant like about the team.
Oh yeah, sorry. So I believe that Atlanta should start looking for a new coach.
A new coach? What are you smoking? Are you hanging with 2 Chainz right now?
First off, that is none of your business. And second, I just think that Tata Martino would be a great hire for the US men's national team. I mean, the guy has been around. He'll have 2 years of experience in this country after this season is over, and he'll demand respect from everyone at every level, both on and off the field. So, in my opinion, US Soccer should find an interim person until this December, and then let Tata do his thing with Atlanta this year, and then let him work his magic at the start of a new World Cup cycle.
Actually, I think that's kind of smart, and I think you might be onto something, but that's a conversation for another time. So let's keep our focus on this season and this season only, so I'll say third. Which leads us with the reigning champions of America's top soccer league, Toronto Football Club from Canada. And I was saving the best for last because they've earned it. For me, Toronto FC represent the new model on what it means to have success in the league. They have a great coaching staff, and I'll admit my bias because I'm friends with all of them, who pride themselves on not only creating a good team, but a great culture that permeates throughout the whole club, all the way down from the youth teams and into the front office. And then you sprinkle in signing some good designated players, specifically the very, very, very special Sebastian Giovinco, mixed with some veterans that know how to have success in MLS, which I assure you isn't always that easy to find. And then finally, you have some younger players that are ready to prove themselves, and you got the right combo for having success for a very, very long time. And I really feel like Toronto has set themselves up to have success for many years to come, including this upcoming season. However, the challenge for them is gonna be in maintaining this success. And since they're gonna be competing in multiple competitions, including the very tough CONCACAF Champions League, it could be difficult to keep the level and quality and focus at a high level. I just said level twice. But knowing the ambition of the whole organization, they're gonna wanna keep raising the bar and making history, and I love that about them, so I think they're gonna get first again. And all right, that is it. That is all I got for the MLS Eastern Conference. So what do you guys think? Do you agree? Do you disagree? Also, be on the lookout tomorrow for the MLS Western Conference preview. Yes, it's gonna be awesome because I get to talk about 2 of my former clubs and a few of my former coaches, and I always enjoy doing that. Also, x2, we're doing a Warren Ballers MLS Fantasy League. So if you guys want to join in on the festivities, then the info is in the description below. Also, x3, if you win the Warren Ballers MLS Fantasy League, I will fly to your house and have a pickup game near where you live for just you and your friends, unless you want to invite everybody. And if you do, that's cool. And if you don't, that's cool too. And then we can play some FIFA 2 if you like to lose, if you're into that, because I'm really good. Or at least that's what I tell myself. So good luck. Later.